In all of these youth cultures, the real stars are never musicians. It's the kids themselves. It's the best dressers. It's the best ones with the best hairdos, the best dancers. It's about making yourself the centre of the scene.
The Soulboy emerged early to mid 70s, and he was one of the later outcrops of mod. Clothes obsessed, dance music obsessed, usually black music dance obsessed. And he had a counterpart in the north of England among the northern soul boys, who particularly liked the classic and usually quite obscure soul of the 60s. The soul boy in the south was interested in contemporary soul. And then laid him by the fireside
with some honey and some milk. Some subcultures are absolutely rooted in a particular geography and in a particular wild kind of enthusiasm. And Northern Soul is a product of that.
From the time I picked up my first copy of Blues and Soul in 1972, I'm reading about all these clubs outside of London, because I, you know, religiously, you know, I'd be reading Blues and Soul, Black Echoes magazine, reading all these charts of Russ Winstanley and a couple of other sort of well-known northern DJs at the time. But if I hadn't have brought you
in, by now you might have died. Wigan. You know, that focus. People went on pilgrimages to Wigan, but that was the real heart of it.
Amazingly, Wigan Casino lasted from September 23rd, 1973 to December 6th, 81. That was over 8 years, 4 million people through the door.
The Northern Soul scene was distinctly British because this was black music from often from the ghettos of America that was being enjoyed by working class white Europeans.
It's a wild, backward-looking enthusiasm about black dance music and sharing very, very rare records.
It was all about having a record that the next bloke didn't have. They're very, very, very intense about it. The crowd is in tonight, begging for more. Down south, it was more of the funky, the James Brown and the style, and we're looking good and everything, and we were tell you what, we're working so flipping hard all week, we're going to dance hard, and we're going to wear the clothes, the loose clothes, the loose pants, it'll be 34-inch waist, 34-inch bottom, so it gets the air wafting up, so it keeps you nice and cool, you know. The girls had these giant skirts on that would spin round and everything, but it was just being comfortable.
They always have their bags with everything in there. It's like a traveling week, and here's my kit. I'm here to dance all night.
They don't dance like funky people, where we dance on the offbeat or we dance in the space between rhythm. We hear it at the beat that's not there, and that's the bit that we're moving to. But they're on the one.
The dancing was like, oh my God, that kid has just done a backdrop. He's just done a spin.
It's like whiz, 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 spin, splits, ding, 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 you know, that was it.
And it was three or four tracks that they used to play. My lips are full. And true to form, they played this tune at the end, and it was like a football match. You know, the whole crowd sort of, everybody singing all the words. It was amazing. It was like church. Let me tell you, long after
tonight is all over. The Soulboy thing didn't even have bands to follow, really. It had records. You had to have the latest import tune. But you didn't follow a band. You didn't go and watch live music, even. It was about going out, dressing up and dancing.
You were part of a wonderful, friendly, atmospheric movement that really was an underground movement, and you had to go to it, not the other way around.
Give it up, boop, boop, boop. Now, I think there was a real distinction. There's Northern Soul and there's Southern Soul. There's a line drawn somewhere through Luton, which you couldn't cross. I was a Southern kid, so I was into peg trousers, plastic sandals.
Jellies were really, really popular, very, very cheap. This was all accessible and cheap. Biggie jeans, sometimes in striking colours.
I loved red jeans, mohair jumpers that I bought from seditionaries.
I remember I got my ear pierced, you know, my mother slapped me around the face.
I liked the fact that we provoked reaction. I loved the fact that, you know, I was beginning to realise that particularly black kids were finding the courage to express themselves in the clothes that they wore.
I think Soulboy fashion was a bit odd, right? And it was mainly made up of two things, the white kid thing and the black kid thing, right? The black kid bought the gabichis, and the white kids, to a degree, bought pegs. They bought Hawaiian shirts. They bought loose-fitting clothes that you could dance in.
The emergence of the Soulboy in the 70s was the platform for the working class black British or second generation black person to basically emulate his white mates safely and dress up. Prior to that, in the 60s and 70s, we were anonymous. We just watched the white kids wear braces, put crombies on, put expensive shoes on, and we realistically couldn't afford to or didn't really aspire to that. But it was my peer group, that generation, we just thought, to hell with that. We love these clothes. We're going to wear them if we can afford them. We'll get the money somehow.
We in the South, specifically in Essex and Kent, had our own soul scene, you know, with DJs like Froggy, Chris Hill, Robbie Vincent, Greg Edwards playing jazz funk.
The epicentre of the Southern funk scene, circa 76, 77, 78, I guess, would have been the celebrated Goldmine Club at the seafront on Canvey Island.
Personality DJs started in the soul scene with the Goldmine on Canvey, with the Case the Weekenders.
I loved the vibe there. Really friendly, but very Essex. You know, and my lot loved it because there was great music, tons of birds.
Essex was the home of soul, of black music in the UK at that particular time. Virtually every night of the week you could go to a different club, and people came from all over the country to go to see Chris Hill and Froggy, and they built up this massive scene that was purely based around music and companionship.
A very important aspect of the Soulboy culture was the multiracial element. This was people of every type, from every background, who were just there to celebrate as well. And there were no political statements as such made overtly by that scene, which is probably why it was lambasted quite a bit, but actually subtly, in a way, they were making a very serious social statement about accepting people from other backgrounds and other races.
It was the first time that I saw black kids and white kids properly together, dancing together, drinking together, going out with each other, and seriously, I never saw it on the punk scene.
I think the soul scene, which was massive, it was what you did if you were a working class kid in Britain in the mid-70s, was almost exclusively ignored because it wasn't about bands. And, you know, the NMEs and the Sounds and all of this, well, they liked writing about bands.
The Northern Soul scene specifically was overlooked by mainstream media because the music that those guys were dancing to, a lot of it was B-sides.
In the NME, they covered it once, and it was in a rather sneering, kind of looked down upon way. These guys all had practical jobs, you know, they had money to spend, they drove cars, it was the Ford Escort with the fluffy dice was the thing for them, and the white socks.
It never left the council estates. Do you see what I mean? It never, because it didn't have figureheads, it didn't have a Johnny Rotten, it didn't have a Cliff Richard, it didn't have the Who. It wasn't about that, it was about the kids themselves. Because it wasn't written about, it wasn't eulogised, it wasn't filmed, it wasn't all of those things, it was left to its own devices. And that's the healthiest thing that can happen to a subculture, because it stays sub, it stays below the radar. Don't give him no peace, son, if you don't mean it from your heart.
We live with the legacy of the Soulboy today. Some people have turned it into huge businesses. They really set the foundations for club culture because there became a network where DJs could move from one to the other. They played recognisable sets which weren't played on the radio. And so by the mid-80s, those clubs started to feed the DJs who then became the superstar DJs and, you know, fed into the rave scene, which made it go absolutely outer national. And we live with it today.
It was very much a forerunner of that kind of clubbing culture that some people think was created in the late 1980s. I was going to warehouse parties, as they were called, in abandoned warehouses in the 1970s. People didn't call it kind of club culture or house or any of that, but that's what it was. My brother gonna work it out.